This is a rare honor. I feel humbled by your decision to confer on me the 2015 Indira Gandhi Memorial Lectureship of the Asiatic Society. This institution is of ancient vintage. Its founder found time and inclination to combine his colonial pursuits with serious scholarly inclinations and to inscribe an expansive objective in the memorandum of articles delineating its areas of work. The bounds of its investigation, it said, would be the geographical limits of Asia, and within these limits, its inquiries will be extended to whatever is performed by man or produced by nature. Colonial rule ended in August 1947. The institution created by Sir William Jones and some others like it remained relevant and continue to do good work of investigating and understanding the work of man and nature. If the primary objective of the colonial rulers was to understand India, to control and rule it more effectively and exploit it more thoroughly, the task bestowed on us today as the citizen body of the Republic is to assess and comprehend the direction of change achieved or is desirable to fulfill the ideals set out in the preamble of the Constitution. The political and administrative integration of post-independence India was at times an exercise in blood and iron and achieved in 1947-48. The achievement and its limitation was commented upon authoritatively by its principal architect, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. This integration of minds extended beyond the formerly princely states and covered the rest of the country also. The reason for this was the presence of human diversities that are both hierarchical and spatial. Hence the necessity of building the political structure, keeping in mind the need to accommodate linguistic, religious and caste sentiments that together account for the 4,635 communities, 78% of whom are not only linguistic and cultural but social categories including religious minorities amounting to 19.4% of the population. Of these, Muslims account for 13.4%, amounting in absolute terms to around 180 million. Much has happened in the past 7 decades. A complex Indian reality has emerged. There is much to celebrate, much to ponder over. Sociologists have argued that the requirement is of broad societal rather than a just a political perspective. Some years back, the late George Verghese had noted the emerging trends of opinion and observed that a culture of silence has yielded to protest and suggested that we need instrumentalities of communication, education, institutions and policies to help negotiate the country's myriad diversities in the years ahead. Two eminent scholars of socio-economic development in modern India have noted that the societal reach of economic progress in India has been remarkably limited, adding that the agenda for political, economic and social democracy remains unfinished because of continued disparity between the lives of the privileged and the rest, and because of persistent ineptitude and unaccountability in the way the economy and society are organized. Given the dimensions of the challenge, the relevance of the course of action suggested by Bhimrao Ambedkar to his followers many years before independence needs to be recalled, and I quote him, "My final words of advice to you is educate, agitate, and organize. Have faith in yourself and never lose hope." End of quote. It has been opined that the modern state is a fictive entity that also maintains a stubborn reality. This necessitates the effort to make it acceptable and trustworthy to its citizens through a state structure and practices that provide physical and emotional security by making it sufficiently accommodative. It leads us to interrogate the evident. The quest could, as with Ananya Vajpayee, begin with the search for self in modern India, and in going beyond a series of binaries like modernity, tradition, secular, religious, Hindu, Muslim, the social, the transcendental, egalitarianism and inequality, modern political society or pre-modern cultural communities. Each of these compels us to question the obvious and the manifest. Thus, the de jure, we the sovereign people, in the first line of the preamble is in reality a fragmented we, divided by yawning gaps that remain to be bridged. This exercise was conducted in the Constituent Assembly and is reflected in its totality in the preamble of the Constitution. It sought to attain justice, social, economic and political, liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship, equality of status and of opportunity, and promotion of fraternity, assuring the dignity of the individual and the unity and integrity of the nation. The Constitution was adopted by the Constituent Assembly on 26 November 1949 and formally came into force on January 26, 1950. Almost 3 years later, Dr. Ambedkar, who chaired the drafting committee, gave a speech on conditions precedent for the successful working of democracy, wherein he defined democracy as a form and method of government whereby revolutionary changes in the economic and social life of the people are brought about without bloodshed. He went on to list the essential ingredients of a working democracy. 1. Absence of glaring inequalities. 2. Presence of an opposition. 3. Equality in law and administration. 4. Observance of constitutional morality. 5. Avoidance of tyranny of majority over minority. And 6. A functioning of moral order in society. 7. Public conscience. Given the overall sense of debates in the Constituent Assembly, it is safe to assume that this text reflected the general approach of those who drafted the document. At the same time, one does not have to be a skeptic to conclude that the last two in Ambedkar's list of requirements might be in short supply today, as also the avoidance of Mahatma Gandhi's 7 social sins inscribed on a tablet near his samadhi at the Rajghat in New Delhi. These fissures raise questions. democratic mobilization, while it has produced an intense struggle for power, has not delivered millions of citizens from abject dictates of poverty. Our quest today is to assess the balance between factors of cohesion and fragility in the polity, and in the process to gauge the achievements and shortcomings on each of these counts, particularly on institutions, integration, empowerment and identity, and gauge their impact on social cohesion, in whose absence inclusive development would be impeded, even distorted. We would overlook at our own peril Ambedkar's caution about a life of contradictions. For this purpose, social cohesion may be defined as the capacity of a society to ensure the welfare of all its members, minimizing disparities and avoiding polarization. Its absence, on the other hand, contributes to fragility. Justice, it has been said, and said rightly, is the first virtue of social institutions, and in a just society, the rights secured by justice are not subject to political bargaining or to the calculus of social interests. It is therefore a matter of satisfaction to us as citizens that the Bill of Rights in our Constitution is comprehensive and includes a judicial mechanism for the enforcement of these rights. Notwithstanding the formal position, however, the challenge of securing justice is a complex process and has been dwelt upon by Professor Amartya Sen. The discussion thus leads us to assess the efficacy of institutions, beginning with the ones relating to representative government. Universal adult franchise has given us an effective tool that has been exercised with great effect over six decades at state and national levels, and has been supplemented powerfully by the 73rd and 74th amendments of 1992. We also hold that the first past the post system has served us adequately. The Supreme Court in 1994 had characterized it as possessing the merit of preponderance of decisiveness over representativeness. Despite this, the first past the post system continues to be the subject of considerable discussion. It has been argued that it has not been possible to uphold majoritarianism in a party system, since the winning candidate wins only about 20 to 30% of the votes. In fact, in the 2014 general election, only 117 of the 379 winning candidates in the Lok Sabha secured 50% or more of the votes cast. This, in the context of the overall national voting percentage of 66.4%, makes evident the actual representativeness of the elected representative. One study showed that it was 31% in 2014. This is accentuated by the unequal presence of weaker sections, especially women and minorities, in the power structure as reflected in elected bodies. In the 2014 general election, women constituted 11% of the total elected Lok Sabha members, and while some religious minorities were well represented, the representation of others is noticeably deficient. A related question pertains to the financing of elections. It is corroding the system. A remedy may lie in state funding that will curb corruption by wealthy parties and support resource-crunched parties. Opinion on implementing it, however, is divided, and this is reflected in the Law Commission report. Today, we are confronted by a paradox. While the registered voter participation in elections has steadily increased, the actual functioning of the legislatures has steadily declined. The Lok Sabha in the period 1952 to 1974 uniformly registered more than 100 sittings each year. The corresponding figure in the years 2000 to 2015 period has never exceeded 85 and has in some years gone as low as 46. The Rajya Sabha sittings in earlier years were at times fewer, but now the two houses adjourn on the same dates. As a consequence, scrutiny of proposed legislation is in many cases perfunctory. Also, less time is available for seeking the accountability of the executive through procedural devices like questions, debates, and discussions. The picture in state legislatures is worse, with some state assemblies being convened in a pro forma exercise for less than 10 days every year. Thus, while the public participation in the electoral exercise has noticeably improved, public satisfaction from the functioning of elected bodies is breeding cynicism with the democratic process itself. The imperative for a corrective is evident to reinforce public confidence in the ability of the system to deliver as intended. Friends, representative governance functions at levels other than national. The Constitution was crafted in the context of its times. Its predecessor, the stillborn Government of India Act 1935, visualized a transition from a unitary to a centralized federal system with provisions for accession by the princely states. The text produced by the Constituent Assembly depicted the Republic as a union of states, aptly described by Ambedkar as both unitary as well as federal according to the requirements of time and circumstances. In recent years, and whenever a party in opposition to the ruling establishment in the center was in power in the state or states, somewhat similar views were articulated in Bihar, Gujarat, Kerala, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Uttar Pradesh, and West Bengal. More specific demands for the devolution of power and for autonomy have been made in Jammu and Kashmir and in Nagaland. The debate on cooperative federalism was rekindled after the last general election. A meeting of the Interstate Council envisaged under Article 263 was held on 16th of July this year after a gap of a decade. Several strident comments on center-state relations and for a radical rearrangement of the union-state relationship were articulated. The Prime Minister, on his part, said his government's main aim has been to promote federalism, be it cooperative or competitive. The Interstate Council, however, is not a permanent body and is not viewed by many as satisfying the demand for a truly federalist structure of governance, since the liberalized economy requires that the center expand the cooperation with the states on issues relating to land, natural resources and investment. It is time to enhance and not reduce state powers. Liberty, equality and fraternity form, as Ambedkar put it, a trinity, and divorcing one from the other is to defeat the very purpose of democracy. Liberty necessitates accommodation and acceptance of the other. This generates fraternity. The critical link in this chain is provided by equality, substantive and not merely formal. It was assessed some years back that poverty rates in the country have declined substantially, going from 54.9% of people in poverty in 1973 to 27.5% in 2004 and 2005, as measured by the National Sample Survey. This has improved further in the past decade. Despite it, three challenges remain. One, historical fault lines along gender, caste, and religious boundaries that remain persistent. Two, global forces have widened the disparities between big cities and villages and between the more advanced states and those mired in economic doldrums. And three, despite some noteworthy achievements, public institutions in most parts of the country have failed in delivering basic services. Thus, the ingredients that would help promote equality remain undelivered in many cases and unevenly distributed in others. It is these impulses that have shifted the political discourse from mere growth-centric to vociferous demands for affirmative action and militant protest politics. Urban middle-class activism, often taking the form of violence, is being increasingly witnessed. Maoism is an extreme manifestation of it. Both are tending to exercise a new hegemony over civil society. Both are also inviting a strong response from the state apparatus, which is alleged by its proponents as endemic, extrajudicial, and unaccounted violence. One consequence of it is reflected in allegations of constraints on freedom of expression. Another, in dilution of efforts at promoting fraternity by constricting the accepted norms of pluralism in our society. Where does India's democratic project stand today? This is the question posed recently by an eminent political scientist. He opines that having successfully overcome the challenges posed by questions of procedural and social legitimacy, the crisis of moral legitimacy is perhaps the severest test yet, and has rekindled the impulse on the one side for a strong leader to fix problems, and on the other for a stronger participatory impulse that demands more information, accountability, and transparency from the rulers, where people act as watchdogs and vote wielders, so that public policy is shaped by popular participation, since only thus will the overall view of the vulnerable and marginalized get better. Committing ourselves 60 years ago to a representative democracy with universal adult franchise was a progressive step. The time has come to further recommit ourselves to a deeper and more participatory and decentralized democracy, a democracy with greater congruence between the people's interest and public policy. We have to acknowledge that the representation system in the Indian democracy has fissures that need attendance, that claims of inclusiveness are only partially valid, that the objective of bestowing equality of opportunity to all citizens remains a promise particularly to the weakest segment, that demands and pressures generated by non-fulfillment of commitments emanating from the Constitution are propelling the state apparatus to resort at times to violent suppression accompanied by curtailment of some fundamental freedoms, that the inherent plurality of Indian society can be endangered by suggestions of uniformity, and that sufficient effort remains to be made to promote tolerance and acceptance as essential civic virtues essential for achievement of fraternity. Immobility, ladies and gentlemen, is not an option, nor is certitude bordering on smugness or panic on an impending doom. A saner course may be to be receptive to the complexities of the Indian reality and its contradictions, respond to it in all its diversity, and refrain from a priori solutions not embedded in ground realities. This is our creed and has been reiterated to be so by leaders of government, past and present. The question of its fuller implementation remains in the realm of public debate. This, to me, is the imperative of our times. Jai Hind.